Welcome back. Well, Sir Michael Parkinson was the king of interviewing stars, over 2,000 famous guests over four decades. So imagine the pressure of having to interview him.
When you sit down with someone fabulous or famous and or both to set the scene for an interview, how important is that first question?
I've never been asked that before.
Evening and welcome.
I think the most important thing about interviewing is to actually establish a relationship with the person sitting opposite, because after all, it's a totally phony operation, all this nonsense around, you know, palaver, walk down the stairs, a band playing, all that sort of stuff. And I don't care who you are, when you reach the bottom of the stairs, you see this stranger opposite you, me, you think, what the hell am I doing here?
So Dickie joins us now. Good morning to you, Dickie. Sad news today, but what a life. You interviewed him a number of times.
Yeah, he was the real deal. He was the right man in the right place at the right time during the golden era of television, if I can put it that way. When the BBC decided to launch a celebrity chat show, someone said to him, well, you should have a crack at that. Mm. And he did. And he was wonderful. And he was curious about people, and he had a lovely manner about him. He was, the word that comes to mind with Michael is authentic. Mm. He was the real deal. Yeah. He was a lovely, lovely man. And he treated people with respect. Mm. That's the other word I would use this morning. You know, he went into an interview wanting it to be good, not wanting to have a shot at anybody or take them down, but to listen to their story, treat them with respect, and make entertaining television. Tick.
Did that.
And that's the thing. I mean, we're so familiar with that manner of his and the way he was able to make the people he interviewed shine.
Yeah.
Dickie, what was it like to interview him?
Well, it was firstly a great privilege. We did a special for the network about 4 or 5 years ago near his hometown in London, a beautiful spot, and to go to his home tour, it was quite intimidating, I must admit. That was my first question to him. I sweated on that first question all the way to London. But he was very generous, very kind, very giving, talking about the early days when, you know, the son of a miner, this grandson of a miner, and his life was in many ways set for him to, you know, go down the mines. And he said to his dad, I'm never going to do that. Mm. His dad said, thank God for that.
He was able to articulate for the nation as well.
He was.
Also just that level of communication. Loved Australia.
Loved Australia. Well, he was very much an English gentleman and loved everything that came with his success. But he loved nothing more than coming to Australia and watching the cricket, you know, sitting in the members' stand at the SCG or the MCG. He loved the food, the wine, the weather, the cricket. Mm. He loved Aussies. He loved that larrikin spirit. You know, Shane Warne was one of his favourite people. I remember during that interview talking about Warney at length.
He was
a lovely man, and he's what a great life.
You're back with a big tribute coming up after 7 o'clock too. Looking forward to that.
Thank you.
Welcome back to the show. Well, Sir Michael Parkinson met Sir Geoffrey Boycott when they were about 15 years of age. One would go on to become a legendary English cricketer, and the other, the most renowned interviewer in the world. Perhaps even more special, a friendship that spanned seven decades.
As the world mourns the loss of Parky, his great mate, Sir Geoffrey, has been kind enough to join us this morning to honour his legacy. Sir Geoffrey, thank you so much for joining us today. I know it's a very sad day for you and really the whole world. We're so sorry for this loss. He was an absolute legend of the screen and a close friend of yours. How are you feeling today?
I knew it was coming. Sadly, he's been deteriorating just with age. He looked very frail over the last few months, and I've been in contact with his son, Michael Jr., and he actually rang me about a week, 10 days ago, and said, look, he just wanted to inform me he's not going to last too long. And he knew that I used to stay with Michael when I played test matches. I mean, you're probably too young to realise we played test matches and we had a rest day on Sunday. And so when I played the London test matches, he would come and watch me play or watch England play, and then he would take me home with him and Mary on Saturday night, because most of the lads in the team at one stage were from the south, and so they went back home on Saturday night to Essex, Kent, Surrey, Middlesex and Sussex. They went to spend Sunday at home with family. Well, it was a long way to go to Yorkshire, so I was left on my own in London. So I spent the Saturday night having dinner with Michael and Mary and their three young children, and then Sunday mornings we'd go for cricket coaching before we had a proper Yorkshire Sunday lunch with roast beef and Yorkshire pudding. Oh. And then it take me back ready for Sunday night, ready for Monday morning cricket. So I saw a lot of him, yes. I stayed with them, and I've known him since I was 15. Mm. I went there when I was 15 to Barnsley, where Dickie Bird became the great umpire. Then he was a very good club player, nervous, but he got 50 every Saturday. He's probably the best player in the league. And Michael was a good left-handed bat, probably a good club standard, minor counties, as we call it, not quite county standard. And so he was moving into journalism with the Guardian, and he was on a topical news show in Manchester, Granada TV, got into that before he started fronting cinema, the great programme, and then got his own talk show. And he used to come back and play in the league, and sometimes he was away, he couldn't play. When he was away and couldn't play, he was away doing interviews, I would get a call at 16 to play in the first team. And when he came back, I got dropped for him, which he found it quite hilarious years later.
I said, Geoffrey, I remember reading that story this morning that he kept you out of the team. That's all true, huh?
Absolutely true. He actually got 100. I researched it some years ago. I did my autobiography and researched it. He got 100 one time when they dropped me at Harrogate. And his father was watching. And his father couldn't watch because he didn't get many hundreds in the league. Nobody did. We played, 47 overs or so. And he hit a six. He slogged it. I tell him he's a slogger. He slogged it into the gent's toilet where his dad was hiding. Absolutely true. And his dad, you know, his dad is the real McCoy, northerner with a Yorkshire accent, brought up in the mines because he was mining area then, mining. Coal mining was everything where we got all the fuel in England. Mm. None of this nuclear and windmill and wind farms and all that. It was purely coal.
Yeah.
And so we grow up where the only thing you had was the pub for a drink and cinema. Cinema was the big escapism, seeing Hollywood stars in that. So, Michael, I was the same. Cinema was everything. We loved it. We loved the stars. He actually named his cat after Robert Mitchum, who was his favourite actor, a big black cat. And I remember Mary, when I stayed with him once, said, Mitch, he had this swan by the neck, because there were white swans on the Thames River at the end of his garden. And the black cat, with nature being to eat birds, it had jumped on this swan, and it couldn't eat it, it couldn't do anything, it wouldn't let go, and the swan was trying to shake it off, and Mary had to go and get Mitch off the swan.
So, Geoffrey, look, it is always very difficult. And we really do thank you for being with us today, because it's difficult to share when you're going through a grief, and especially for the family.
I did a lot of interviews today, lot of interviews. But listen, he was the best at interviewing because the modern-day people that interview you, it's an interrogation. Mm. They jump in. They don't let you finish the question, a lot of them. They're trying to catch you out. Michael did it differently. He loved people. He loved the Hollywood stars that came on. He loved the sports of football and cricket that he had. And he just chatted to them. He always said, as if he was in his front room. Mm. So they felt at ease. They just talked. It was no hassle. And they actually gave him more because they felt comfortable and they felt good about it. He got funny stories, anecdotes, all kinds of things. Because he just chatted to him. And that was the beauty of it, the cleverness. He had no ego about it. He always said to me, the real star is the person you're interviewing, not you. Mm. You get the reflected glory when people say, did you see Parkinson's show last night? Wasn't so-and-so brilliant? Great fun. And he said, the people today, a lot of the kids, they're wanting to make a name for themselves by trying to catch people out, trying to, you know. And he said, there's no need to be aggressive. If you like you, they just chat, make them feel comfortable, and you'll get the best out of them.
Yeah, he was so good with people.
Mm. All right, so I'm not going to interrupt you, but I fully appreciate you being with us and sharing some stories. We look forward to seeing you back in Australia sometime soon, maybe for the next Ashes.
Yeah.
I'd love to, but I'm getting a bit old like Michael. Who knows?
You'll be right. Thank you,
Thanks,
mate.
Thanks, Geoffrey.
We're paying tribute to the incredible life of Sir Michael Parkinson this morning. The legendary broadcaster interviewed singers, sportsmen, comedians, and during his stint in Australia, a few Aussie politicians.
We'll just serve my next guest that he lives his life in headlines as vivid as the stories he covers. Shortly before his marriage to the actress Jackie Weaver, he took a full-page advert in a newspaper declaring his love for her. Before that, he announced the breakup of his affair with another actress, Linda Stoner, on his radio phone-in programme. As a writer and broadcaster, he's got a reputation of being tough and aggressive. Indeed, the Prime Minister of New Zealand, Mr. Robert Muldoon, was once moved to denounce him as a ratbag. Ladies and gentlemen, Derryn Hinch. What could a nice, gentle soul like you have said to that lovely man, Mr. Muldoon, for him to have called you a ratbag?
Oh, I think I said he was an arrogant, pugnacious, belligerent bully. And I think from memory, I said he made Malcolm Fraser look like Mahatma Gandhi.
Nothing wrong with that, is there?
And that ratbag, Derryn Hinch, joins us now. Derryn, good morning to you. Lovely to see you this morning, my man. Fond memories, huh?
Yeah, good morning. Funnily enough, somebody just sent me that clip a few days ago, because on the same interview with Michael Parkinson, I scoffed at the idea of ever becoming a politician. which of course turned out. Do you know, the thing about Parkinson was, unlike a lot of interviewers, this is why he was so good, unlike a lot of interviewers who, like Don Lane, who followed a cheat sheet, he actually listened. Mm. He listened to the person who was answering a question, and he would base the next question on what they said, rather than just, oh, okay, what's next? And he was brilliant, he really was.
Getting rid of this.
Sorry?
I've just got a cheat sheet here. I'm just going to...
Your cheat sheet?
Get rid of that. We're not taking the shot. And there we go. I'm just going to wing it, Derryn. Oh, no, I forgot what I was going to ask. A very skilled interviewer and really connected. What was it like for you to be interviewed? Did you think about it before you went in there?
It was a bit daunting. Actually, I think my flatmates... His girlfriend was a Parkinson producer, so I knew a bit about the show. I watched the show, of course, and the good thing about Parkinson, he absolutely loved Australia. It was totally genuine, his commitment to Australia, his obsession almost with cricket was well known. And anybody on the up and up, if you got on Parkinson, you had it made. And that was the thing. He was, I think, probably, along with David Frost, two of the most famous interviewers in the world.
Yeah, I love David Frost as well. One of a kind. Did you get to spend much time with him outside of it all?
No, I didn't. No, we weren't even acquaintances. No, I was just another interviewee. Ironically, the show I was on a guy called Neville Rann,
yeah,
and his new wife called Jill. So that was quite sweet. I think this is why we're not talking about politicians and politics, and why I said I'd... No way, no, I'll ever get into politics.
Derryn, you're going to have to come back to nightly current affairs and give us a bit of That's Life again. Huh?
No, I'm past all that. I've actually got a column in the online magazine, The Big Smoke, yesterday about what it's like to be semi-retired. I hate the term semi-retired, because I'm not. I'm still writing. I've got a new book coming out for Hardy Grant, a book of short stories.
Yeah.
That's coming out in October, I think it is. So I've been working on that. But I hate the idea of retired or semi-retired. Mm. I mean, you think about all those old jokes about when you're old, you think every old person thinks... what the bleep happened, number one. And number two, housewives say to their husbands in the kitchen when he's telling you how to cook an egg, say, hey, I married you for life, not for lunch.
And on that note, it's always good to see you, Derryn. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Sarah.
He's always got a curly one, doesn't he?
Yes, we begin this Friday with our farewell to renowned British broadcaster Michael Parkinson, the interviewer, journalist and author, passing away aged 88, being remembered this morning as the king of the chat show.
Whether it was singers, actors or sporting icons, anybody who wanted to be anybody found themselves opposite Michael's signature interview style.
That theme drew millions to the television sets each week.
Evening and welcome.
If you wanted a sure sign that you'd made it as a celebrity, sitting next to Michael Parkinson would do it.
The actors were all looking at the musicians. Look at those musicians. They've got it so easy. All they can play the guitar and stand up and sing.
And then you've got comedians down the end.
Yeah, they're all goofing around.
Born in Yorkshire in 1935, the son of a miner, he started his journalism career straight out of school in newspapers before moving into television in the 1960s. And in 1971, started the program that made him a household name.
I think you've got to accept, John, and yourself, that, I mean, particularly you, John, that it's alienated you from the people who originally loved you in this country.
Them, yeah.
Yes, I think they don't understand you anymore.
The alienation started was when I met Yoko, and people do not seem to like people getting a divorce.
Parkinson himself was nearly always genial and unflappable, although he wasn't afraid to tackle Kerry Packer over World Series cricket.
He actively recruited people, Kerry, while he was captain of England, privy to important information on the other side.
There hasn't been any important information on the other side for 100 years.
He was in the...
He was a frequent visitor to Australia.
We met in the lift in Sydney, I think, for the first time, many years ago. Mm-hmm. My second home, Sydney.
In 1979, he brought his program Down Under, inviting our biggest names into his Sydney studio.
He's been described as Australian as Vegemite. Ladies and gentlemen, Bob Hawke. Ladies and gentlemen, Johnny Farnham. Ladies and gentlemen, Bert Newton.
Australia, Australian television, life in Australia, talk to us.
It's very interesting going to Australia. You know, it's such a long, long way away that when you get there, it's like being on another planet.
Embracing Dame Edna.
Funnily enough, exciting though it has been, I felt a sense of gratitude from the audience when I came on.
Calling Shane Warne a genius.
Tell us a story about the boomerang. I love this story.
I've still got the scar just here.
This is a metaphor for your life, you know, this is.
Sort of threw the boomerang and didn't quite get it right. And then once I got it right and sort of just kept going around, I thought, oh, that's pretty good. And suddenly it started coming towards me. I thought, geez, I better try and catch that.
In his later years, he had a long fight with cancer, but there were no complaints, just reflections on a life spent seeking answers.
I loved every minute of it. I've been a very, very lucky man indeed.
What an incredible legacy, an incredible man, wasn't he?
Amazing.
Well, let's bring in Nine Europe correspondent Carrie-Anne Greenbank at Parky's old BBC studios in London. Carrie, we're hearing so many of the famous names he interviewed.
Morning, Sarah. Well, by his own estimate, Sir Michael Parkinson says he believes he interviewed around 2,000 of the world's biggest stars over the decades that his chat show ran. It started here at the old BBC studios in 1971, and dozens of those stars have been paying tribute to the veteran broadcaster. His family has also released a statement. He's survived by his wife, Mary, and three children. The family statement reads, after a brief illness, Sir Michael Parkinson passed away peacefully at home last night in the company of his family. Now, I've heard from David Beckham saying, we say goodbye to the best. Waking up to the sad news of Michael Parkinson passing, I was so lucky to not just be interviewed by Michael, but to be able to spend precious time talking about football and family, our two passions. He even refers to that priceless golden balls moment there. Sir Elton John says Michael Parkinson was a TV legend who was one of the greats. I loved his company. He calls him a real icon who brought out the very best of his guests. That is a running theme through the tributes today. And Sir David Attenborough also saying the best interviewer in the business. He was extremely generous. He wanted you to shine and would always laugh at your jokes. And today the BBC has announced it will be interrupting its broadcasting to run a special documentary honouring the veteran broadcaster's life. Sarah.
That'll be one to watch. Thanks so much, Carrie-Anne.